Hey folks, I'm Sam Luce here with iZotope. Mid-side processing is a type of processing that can have powerful implications for your mix and master. But with great power comes great responsibility. In this video, I want to walk you through a few ways that you can use mid-side processing, but also highlight a few pitfalls that beginners often make. But first, let's define what is mid-side processing and how can we use it.
Now grab your favorite set of headphones or sit in front of a good set of speakers so you can hear the full effect of what mid-side processing is achieving.
Typically when we think of audio, we think of it in terms of mono or stereo. If an audio source is mono, like my voice that you're listening to now, it appears to come from the center of the stereo spectrum because it is exactly the same in the left speaker as it is in the right. This is the mid component of mid-side processing. Anytime there is a difference between what comes out the left and the right speaker, that is when we're dealing with stereo, and this is what you'll be affecting when you're processing the side signal. Here you can see my voice on Ozone's display. In mid-side mode, if I bring the high frequencies of the mid-channel up, it will affect my voice. However, if I bring them up on the side channel, nothing will happen. This is because my voice is mono and doesn't occupy the side channel. If I bring up a bed underneath my voice and now affect the high frequencies of the side channel, it's making a difference. This is because the track has stereo information that is different in the left and the right. Therefore, it is affected by processing the side channel. Often when we think of mid-side compression, we think of dynamic elements of a mix that appear in the center channel, the mid. This could be a kick drum, a snare drum, or any other centrally panned transient instrument. If we have an issue with an instrument like a snare, as we do in this mix, then the temptation is to compress that mid-channel in an attempt to combat the issue. But the problem with this type of approach is that you're also going to be affecting every other instrument in that center channel, and you could risk altering the balance of your mix. So this is where the multiband mode in Ozone is most helpful. We can zone in on the frequency range that the snare occupies to make sure that we're only affecting that instrument, not the kick, not the vocal, or any other instruments that are also in that mid-channel. Let's zone in to identify where the snare lies and just compress that frequency range. In Ozone, you can switch to mid-side mode by clicking on the menu that currently says stereo and selecting mid-side. You can solo this band by clicking the S. Once we've identified where the snare lies, we can bring the threshold down and take a listen to the result. The high end of the snare will remain, but the problematic low end will no longer poke out the mix. It's possible to make your mix sound wider by using mid-side EQ and boosting the higher frequencies in the side channel. This typically consists of guitars, keyboards, drum overheads, and often effects. Now, whilst this is a great technique to employ, it's very easy to overdo and leave yourself with a mix that is far too bright in the side channels simply because you didn't compare it to the original mix enough. Brighter and louder will often sound better to our ears, but it's important to remain objective and keep that brightening at bay by bypassing the boost often. Let's turn this EQ into mid-side mode and bring up those high frequencies in the side channel. It sounds nice and bright, but when I'm removing it, I can hear that I'm actually overdoing the effect and making the mix sound thin and brittle in comparison. If this is happening for you, try reining the effect in a touch. Move on to your next processing stage and see if you miss it. You can always add more later. You could also try a different type of high shelf, such as the Baxandale, which will be a lot smoother to the ear. Sometimes, knowing how to use mid-side processing means knowing when not to use it. If you're using mid-side processing, then it means that every move you make is going to be governed by your initial panning of your mix. If you're processing the mid-channel, then you're processing everything that is panned centrally. If you're processing the side-channel, it means you're going to be processing absolutely everything that is panned to left or right. The biggest mistake you can make with mid-side processing is not having initially thought about your panning and frequency content. Now, for the majority of this video, we've been thinking about audio in a mastering sense. But if you have access to your mix session and you're not just working from a stereo file, then the best way is always going to be going back to your mix and altering panning or frequency content there. So you're not trying to fix things using mid-side processing, and you can concentrate on using it in a creative way. If you can't go back to your mix and just have the stereo master to work with, here's a way of getting some more definition out of your vocal. The vocal needs to be at the front of the mix and will typically lie in the center of the stereo spectrum, the mid channel. To help this cut through, we could use mid-side EQ to boost the area where the vocal is sitting. The only issue here though is that we would also be boosting the other instruments that lie in the same area of the frequency spectrum, even when that vocal is not present, which is not the aim. This is where dynamic EQ comes into play and can help us to achieve that upfront vocal without affecting other elements of the mix. Let's solo a band in the mid-range to work out where the majority of the vocal lies and boost that area using our dynamic EQ. I can switch this plugin to mid-side mode in the same way as before. That's helping the mid-range of the vocal cut through just above 1 kHz. But remember that the vocal is a harmonically rich instrument that is going to occupy a greater area of the spectrum than just one band can cover. Don't be afraid to bring in another band to boost other qualities of the vocal. Here I'd like to get a bit more definition to this vocal in a slightly higher area than I've already affected. So I'm going to do the same thing again in the 2 to 3 kHz region, and have these two bands working together to bring the vocal to the front of the mix. Remember, these boosts may seem extreme if you're looking at this in terms of a static EQ move, but these bands are dynamic, so the actual boosts being applied are the moving white lines underneath the coloured boosts, which are moving far less. In this track, I want to keep the high frequency energy up for when the track kicks in with that first chorus, but I want to just bring down the hi-hats slightly. And we can do this extremely easily using dynamic EQ, but with one extremely important difference to the way you might anticipate. Initially, we may think that if we're bringing down a hi-hat, then that's high-frequency information. So a shelf bringing down the high frequencies when they're present is going to be the best course of action. But what we're actually doing there is taking a lot of the energy out of the track that we previously brought in using the high-frequency boost in the side channel. We're going to be far better off surgically zoning in using Ozone's band shelf filter. So on this same dynamic EQ as we used for the vocal, I'm going to switch from the mid channel to the side channel and start zoning in on this hi-hat. Mid-side processing can be a tricky concept to master, but once you understand it, you can employ these techniques in your mixes and masters and avoid the pitfalls that may have tripped you up as a beginner. Another super important part of mixing is frequency masking. Fortunately, I've created another video for you that you can check out just down below. And you can be sure to master these two concepts and use them in your next mix and masters. Thanks so much for checking it out. I'll see you again soon. Take care.